Information, please. Presented each week at this time by Canada Dry, famous the world over for its fine beverages. Wake up, America. Time to stump the experts and enjoy a glass of refreshing Canada Dry ginger ale. Every week at this time, Canada Dry sets up a board of four experts for you to aim your stumpers at. If you manage to hit the bullseye with a question they cannot answer, you ought to feel pretty good. Here's the way it goes. You may submit from one to three questions with the correct answers. For every question we use, whether or not it's answered correctly, the sender gets $5. And if your question stumps our board of experts, you not only get $10 more, but in addition, you receive a complete 24-volume set of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. Mind you, this is only if your question stumps the board of experts. Our editorial staff may reword your question a trifle. Don't worry about it. Whenever there is a duplication of questions, Information Please uses the one that was submitted first. All questions become the property of Information Please and should be addressed to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City. Or if you live in Canada, Canada Dry, Toronto. And now may I present our master of ceremonies, Mr. Clifton Fadiman, literary critic of the New Yorker magazine. Mr. Fadiman.
Ladies and gentlemen, Information Please continues on its merry, spontaneous, and completely unrehearsed way. Tonight we have at our mercy our three regulars. John Kieran, the sports authority, seems to remember everything he's ever read, seen, or heard. Franklin P. Adams, the conductor of the conning tower in the New York Post, has just about the same kind of memory. And Oscar Levant, the famous pianist and composer, keeps on startling us each week with his phenomenal musical knowledge and talent, with a good deal of general information thrown in. As our guest, we are delighted to welcome that distinguished British character actor of stage and screen, Sir Cedric Hardwick, who opens on the 28th of this month in The Hunchback of Notre Dame. To our listeners, we say, remember, for each question that's missed, Canada Dry rings up $10, and that's paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the latest edition of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Gentlemen, we're off with a question coming to us from John Thomas of this city. Now, suppose you were to go to a travel bureau, and you were to recite the following lines from well-known songs and poems. Where would the ticket agent infer that you wished to go? Now, we have to get three out of four on this. The first is the line, "This precious stone set in the silver sea." Sir Cedric and Mr. Kieran. Sir Cedric.
England.
England. What is the line from?
It's from Richard II, speech by John of Gaunt.
Yes, and it refers, of course, to Sir Cedric's home country, "This precious stone set in the silver sea." Now, suppose you recited this simple phrase, "Far, far away." Where would the ticket agent infer you wish to go? Mr. Adams, they all have their hands up. Mr. Adams?
Swanee River.
Yes, which would be in what state, by the way, Mr. Adams?
It might be in Florida.
Yes, it is in Florida, though I think part of it is in the state just north of
Georgia.
Florida. Georgia, that's right. Now, suppose you recited these lines. "Elephants a piling teak in the sludgy, squudgy creek." Mr. Kieran had his hand up.
India.
I think not quite.
On the road to Mandalay.
On the road to Mandalay. I think probably in Burma. Isn't it a Burma girl a setting somewhere there, Mr.
Well,
Kieran?
Well, it's not in Pennsylvania.
No, Burma is not in Pennsylvania. You're quite right. So, Cedric, is Burma considered part of India? You don't have to answer the question if you don't.
In a very general way, I would say.
Well, actually, if you read the poem, which is, of course, Kipling's famous Road to Mandalay.
There's a Burma girl, a set.
Yes, and she's probably home, setting home, Mr. Kieran. The answer east of Suez, Mr. Kieran, I guess would be just as good, though somewhat vaguer. "Elephants a-piling teak in the sludgy, squudgy creek where the silence sung that ever he was half afraid to speak," and so forth. Well, we've got three out of three so far. How about this one, which is the last? "Where the fellas chew tobacco and the women wicky-wacky-woo." Mr. Levant.
Wait a minute.
Can't hear a word so far, Mr.
Nagasaki.
Levant. Nagasaki is right. It's a
by Harry Warren. I know that.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember the lines in which?
Well, tobacco, wacky,
hot ginger, and dynamite. There's nothing but that at night back in Nagasaki, where the fellas chew tobacco and the women wicky wacky.
Wacky wacky woo. Yeah.
How far back is that song, Mr. Levant?
No more than 10.
That's why
10
Mr.
Years.
Adams didn't get it.
No more than 10 years.
Or were you going to get it, Mr. Adams?
Never heard of it.
Never heard of it.
Well, that's a little too esoteric.
Something for you to add to your repertoire. Sorry, Mr. Adams. Four out of four.
Don't believe it yet.
A bewildered figure. The next question comes to us from the co-author of that charming play, Life with Father, now running on Broadway, Mr. Russell Krauss of this city. Mr. Krauss wants you gentlemen to name five well-known women who have the same first names as the Quints, the famous Canadian quintuplets. Now, all you have to do is to remember what those five names are and give me the names of five well-known women, living or dead.
I can name a boy named Dion.
That's nice. Let's
Dion Busico.
Oh, Dizzy Dion will do just as well, Mr. LeBac. No, I want women. I want women.
I don't remember their names. They're the Dion quintuplets.
Now, you can work together on this, gentlemen. There are only five of them. Mr. Levant, first?
Annette is one of the names.
Annette is one of them. Let's have another famous Annette.
I know a singer named Annette Henshaw. I don't know how famous she is.
I don't know. She seems famous from this moment on. Mr. Cedric.
Annette Kellerman.
Kellerman, yes. Mr. Kieran.
Is one of the Quinns named Yvonne?
Yep.
Yvonne Plantin.
Yvonne Plantin. Who is
That's
Yvonne Plantin?
French actress, the wife of Sacha Guitry the Younger, I believe.
No Frederick. More. She's the wife of Pierre Frenet.
Well, I can't keep up with them.
No, Mr. Levant knows that sort of thing, Mr. Kieran. You ought to be careful when you're trying to figure out who is married to whom. Mr. Levant?
Cécile Sorel, a very great French actress of the Comédie. Will you help me out?
Comédie Française.
Comédie Française, yes. Very good. Cécile. That gives us two more. The other two Quins, we've had Cécile, Annette, and Yvonne. I'm sure that practically everyone listening in can repeat the five names right off the reel, but these distinguished big brains seem stumped.
Give the initial of one of the names.
Oh, I hate to do that, Mr. Levant. You're just coaxing me.
Alexander Wolcott isn't one of them, is it?
No. I think he's applied for admission.
Emile or A.
All right, Mr. Levant. You've got it practically. Emile is the name of a man. Now,
well, give me the feminine.
Well, what is the feminine?
Sir Cedric Hardwick.
Cedric?
Emily.
Emily, yes, and you can give me the English equivalent.
Emily
all right?
Post, my tutor.
Emily Bronte.
Emily Levant. Post.
Emily Post, yes,
that your own successful
Cedric.
Tutor.
That was Mr. Adams being friendly to Mr. Levant. Sir Cedric, what were you were going to name?
Emily Bronte.
Yes, Emily Bronte. A little more in the classic line.
Not a right name, just the same.
Emily Bronte, that was a right
Bronte
name.
Bronte was not a right name.
Yes, it was. Yeah, she was born a Bronte. Practically everybody in England at that time was born a Bronte. You know, all the sisters were named
You're
Bronte.
You're going to get letters about this.
Now we have... No. Emily Bronte is right. Now we've got four of the Quins. We have to get five out of five. I'm sorry, gentlemen. The fifth and last Quinn, and if they're listening, I hope you don't feel that we're being unfair to you, Marie, is Marie. Marie, and a famous Marie would be...
Marie...
Mr. Adams?
Dressler.
Yes, Marie Dressler, Marie Curie... Marie Antoinette. I'm
Sweet
sorry,
Mary.
Gentlemen. That loses us $10, courtesy of Canada Dry, going out to Mr. Krauss. Now, the next question, coming to us from Chestnut Hill, Pennsylvania, and thought up by Mr. Francis Rue Steele, is a musical question. The studio pianist is going to play three melodies from orchestral works which are carried by solo instruments. I want you to identify the work and the solo instrument that carries the melody. Is that perfectly clear?
No, I don't know what carry means. Carry me what? All right, go ahead.
You know, yeah. Just...
Go ahead.
The burden of the melody, as it were. Our studio pianist will play the first. Does it occur to you, Mr. Levant?
Yeah, I think there's a very famous ostinato figure in that.
Way over my head already.
That's in a pastoral symphony.
What number?
Beethoven.
Mm-hmm. Number?
Number six,
oh,
Pastoral
right,
Symphony.
Right. I've got to pin you down. And what solo instrument carries the melody?
It sounds like an oboe.
It is the oboe, indeed.
But there's a very famous accompaniment by the bassoon. It goes, yum, bom, bom. Is that right, Joe? Yeah, that ostinato's quite famous.
And what more popular melody seems to resemble that one, Mr. Levant? Mr. Kieran?
Oh, where is my little dog gone?
Yes, that's right. It resembles the melody, but it's not quite the same, I believe. Now, shall we have the second?
That's up Mr. Kieran and Mr. Adams' department.
I think you don't like the music, Mr. Levant. Sir Cedric, did you have
Samson's
your hand?
Lila. No.
Sorry.
No,
I'm sorry. That's almost totally wrong.
Let him play it again. I think the three of us can manage, or four of us can manage.
All right, get your heads together.
It's either William Tell or the other thing that bothers me, poet and peasant.
Yes, make up your mind, Mr. Levant.
They're the same thing to me. I never can get them straight. You wouldn't know that, John.
Would you like to, Mr. Kieran? Which
I think it must be poet and peasant because I don't know it. And I know Wilhelm Tell.
Poet and peasant is quite right. Principe is poet and peasant. And the melody, Mr. Levant, is carried by what instrument?
Well, I don't know. I'll guess. Is it a clarinet?
No, it's a cello.
Cello.
I'm sorry.
I should say I don't know.
It's a cello. That was a good guess. The third and last of these melodies.
That I know.
You know that, Mr. Levant?
Yeah. It's a very famous and wonderful prelude to the fourth movement of the Brahms C minor symphony, number one.
That's quite
French
right.
French horn.
The French horn. You knew that right off the bat.
Well,
I
even
good.
Used that in a moving picture once. In the President Vanishes. I don't know why.
I bet you would have remembered even if you've never seen the motion
That's
picture.
That's a remarkable
I know you
thing.
Owe a great deal to motion pictures, Mr. Levant.
I like
we got,
Brahms better.
Two out of three. We were supposed to get all on that. That means that courtesy of Canada Dry, Mr. Steele will get the sum of $10 and Encyclopedia. Now, gentlemen, the next question comes to us from Ethel Starr Stockton of Corpus Christi, Texas. Name three novels or plays in which there are no female characters. Name three novels or plays in which there are no female characters. Sir Cedric.
Journey's End.
Journey's End by R.C. Sheriff would be one, yes. Mr. Levant.
Not the women. Wait a minute.
Don't get your sex.
How about the seven that were hanged?
I never read it and don't
yes,
know.
Yes, by Andreev. In case we're wrong, we'll get those letters.
I have a feeling that there... I'm not sure, but it seems to me there were some female characters in that novel.
It was awful short, and they were seven had to be killed. I don't think there were.
I think there were probably just time maybe for one or two of the ladies. Mr. Adams?
The Emperor Jones and Beyond the Horizon.
The Emperor Jones.
The Emperor Jones, certainly.
Yes, I think that's quite right, Mr. Adams. And what was the other one? Beyond the Horizon. No, that's quite wrong.
No, that isn't it.
No, take that back. Do you mind?
I take that back.
We have two. We have two. Mr. Kieran, I can think of a very well-known play in which there are no female characters. Right up your alley, too. This is going to be a joke.
You know me, Al?
No, Tinker to Evers to Chance. Isn't that a well-known play in which there are no female characters?
Yes, very good.
Very good. Let's have another one. Mr. Levant.
I'm going to guess. Maybe John can correct me. Is The Maelstrom by Edgar Allan Poe?
It's not a novel or play. There are no female characters.
Well, it bored me, and I read it. What is it?
Just a man in a whirlpool. I don't think I'll accept it, Mr. Levant. Mr. Kieran.
Well, there's a very famous novel that everybody knows in which a woman is mentioned or appears slightly, but it has nothing to do with the story. That's Treasure Island.
I think, isn't there the mother of Jim Hawkins?
She just mentioned it at the start.
But I do think she appears.
I know the author of a play, but I don't know the name of the play. The play by Rudolf Bézier.
Oh,
what one is it?
I can't remember the name of it. He's the author of the play.
Didn't he write The Barretts?
No.
You wrote The Barretts.
Yes, he did write The Barretts of Wimpole Street, but surely there's a woman in that.
Yeah,
I'm
yes.
sorry not to be able to help you, Sir Cedric. I don't know the name of the play. Well, there are two novels by Joseph Conrad that have no female characters, The Nigger of the Narcissus and Typhoon. And there's a famous novel by John Masefield. Perhaps some of you may know it.
Bird of Dawning.
That's right, Sir Cedric. That gives us three, and we were required to get only three. The next question comes from Louise Mullins of West Medford, Massachusetts. Well, you'll have to go back quite a little way to remember the answers to this question, gentlemen. What plays are associated with the following well-known phrases? There are four of them, and we have to get three out of four. First phrase is, nobody loves a fat man, which you surely must have heard. Mr. Adams.
The play that Macklin Arbuckle was in.
Absolutely right. About what date would you say? I'm going to corkscrew this out of you, Mr. Adams.
About 1908.
Very good, 1907. And what was the play called?
Can't remember.
Well, it's a tough one. I think you're doing very well to remember Macklin Arbuckle, who in the play wore white pants and, while rolling a cigarette in one hand, sat on a table and soliloquized, saying, nobody loves a fat man, in the play called The Roundup by Edmund Bay, I believe. Is that right, Mr. Adams?
That's right.
Does it come back to you now? Suppose I give you 50% on that. Is that all right with you?
Oh, that's dandy.
And you don't have to stay after school either. Now, the next phrase is Hawkshaw the detective. Ooh. Hawkshaw, Sir Cedric.
Take it or leave, man.
Take it or leave, man. That's quite right. Do you remember it, Sir Cedric? Remember having seen it?
Yeah, I saw it when I was very young.
Very, very young. Hawkshaw announces himself as he snatches off his disguises. Do you remember at various points in the play announcing Hawkshaw the detective? Who played the part? Possibly recollect
I think
that?
Edmund Willard played it in England.
Now, he may have. I have down here Tom Taylor. Would that mean anything to you, Sir Cedric?
Well, he wasn't an English actor. I saw it
no,
in England.
Quite right. That gives us one absolutely correct and 50% on the first. Here is the third phrase. My best friend and severest critic. Mr. Levant.
It's either one of two plays of Kaufman and Connolly's. I don't know which one. It either could be Dulcie or Merton. I don't know.
Which
Mr. Adams ought
to... Which do you think, Mr. Adams?
I think it's Merton.
It was a play by Harry Leon Wilson.
The novel was by Harry Leon Wilson. The play, as Mr. Levant says...
was Merton of the Movies.
Merton of the Movies. I think, Mr. Levant, you had just said that it was Merton of the Movies, so you both get full credit for that.
I only want a few percent.
They're all right. Suppose we give you 50%. That gives us 2 out of 3 so far. And the last phrase is... Kiss me, my fool. Kiss me, my fool.
Give me it all. I want to hear the whole thing.
You like that? That's all I know.
I think.
It exhausts me to say that much, Mr. Levant. Mr. Adams.
I think that was a play called A Fool There Was by Porter Emerson Brown.
That's absolutely right. About what date, Mr. Adams?
About Theodore Barra's date. She was in
that. Well, I don't know how far, but 1909. Seems a long time ago. Well, we got 3.5 out of 4 on that, gentlemen. Good enough. That means that, let's see. That vacant expression has dimmed the bright little faces of our experts twice, meaning that Canada Dry has had to pay out $20 and 2 sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, Mr. Cross, can you fill this recess period with something brilliant?
Indeed I can, Mr. Fadiman, because once again I'm going to use our helpful friend William Shakespeare as a springboard. In Henry V, he writes, 'Tis ever common that men are merriest when they are from home.' That observation, made 3.5 centuries ago, is just as true today as it was then. Especially during this holiday season are men and women merriest when they are from home. And they're from home a great deal, because parties are the order of the day. Parties in the office, in restaurants, clubs and hotels, and of course in other people's homes. And wherever laughter and pleasant conversation are heard, the chances are you'll find Canada Dry ginger ale and sparkling water playing an important role in the festivities. For Canada Dry is a delicious ginger ale, and Canada Dry water is a perfect club soda. Together, these two famous refreshers contribute greatly to the joy of the occasion. So, for merriment's sake, be well stocked with sparkling Canada Dry water, the perfect club soda, and Canada Dry, the champagne of ginger ales.
And, Mr. Cross, your interesting little party took place in exactly 65 seconds. We'll go on with a question coming to us from Josephine Johnson of Provincetown, Massachusetts. From where had these travelers come, and to what places were they going? First, the two grenadiers. We have to get 3 out of 4 on this, gentlemen. The two grenadiers.
It's a song.
Mr. Levant.
Schumann set the song. That's
yes,
good
wrote,
enough for me.
Who wrote the poem, Mr. Levant?
Is it G-O-E-T-A? No.
No.
Well,
it's H-E-I-N-E, which is even easier to pronounce.
Really?
Heinrich Heine.
Is that right?
The famous poem called The Two Grenadiers, but we haven't answered the question, Mr. Levant.
Mr. Adams?
They were coming from over the Rhine and they went to France.
They were coming from the Rhine and going to France?
Mm-hmm.
No, that's wrong in every particular, Mr. Adams.
Well, maybe it was vice versa.
Yeah, it's practically vice versa. No, they were coming back from Russia and they were going to France.
Well, I guess it's a couple of other grenadiers.
The lines, in a very bad English translation, if I may say so, are to France were returning 2 grenadiers. In Russia, they both had been taken. So they were coming back from Russia, I guess, during the retreat from Moscow to France. Famous poem by Heinrich Heine, formerly known as a German poet. From where had this traveler come, and to what place was he going? Passepartout. Passepartout. P-A-S-S-E-P-A-R-T-O-U-T. Mr. Kieran, my spelling is correct.
Spelling is correct and pronunciation is beautiful.
But should we stop now and just abandon this entire program on this high note?
What are the initials, please?
I don't think he had another name, Passepartout.
Must have been a French thief.
Passepartout is a character in Jules Verne's 80 Days Around the World. He was Fogg's manservant. And he was going to what place and coming from what place? Sir Cedric, as a good, true-born Englishman, you really should know this. Well, in 80 Days Around the World, Passepartout left London to go around the world in 80 days, and, of course, his destination was what?
London.
Yes, as every good Englishman's destination is. Very good. That gives us one wrong. The King of France, coming and going. Mr. Adams.
Up and down the hill.
Up and down the hill. With what accompaniment, Mr. Adams?
A lot of men.
How many?
I think it may have been 10,000.
Oh, 20,000. Be generous, Mr. Adams. 20,000. 20,000 men, yes. 20,000.
Those were the days, huh?
Yes. The King of France went up the hill with 20,000 men. The King of France came down the hill and ne'er went up again. Nellie and I. Where had Nellie and I come from, and where were Nellie and I going?
In the gloaming.
Was it Nellie in the gloaming, Mr. Levant?
No, I don't know.
I think you've got your gals mixed up. Mr. Adams.
Home.
That's right, yes. Who's home, Mr. Adams?
Nellie's home.
Nellie's home. And where were they coming from?
Aunt Dinah's quilting party.
Aunt Dinah's quilting party is quite correct. That gives us 3 out of 4. Thank you, gentlemen. Question coming from A. Healy of Detroit. This is a question directed at Mr. Levant. The pianist is going to play the right hand of 3 well-known piano pieces. And Mr. Levant is asked to identify these pieces and supply the left-hand portion of each. Will the studio pianist please refrain from letting Mr. Levant's right hand know what your left hand is doing? Go ahead. Let's have the first of them.
I can do the same thing, but that's all.
Well, you have to do it with your left hand. What piece is it, Mr. Levant?
I don't know.
It's a tough one.
You want me to be frank?
Yes, be frank.
I don't know.
Very good. I'd like to hear you say that twice. It rarely happens
in
this program. Well, the answer is, it's the Chopin B minor prelude. Now that you know that, could you give us the left hand?
No, I don't know the prelude.
All right.
Outside of the one they use in moving pictures.
Sorry, we can't oblige
that's
you.
That's the only one I know.
All right, shall we have the second composition? Got that, Mr. Levant?
Yeah, the Chopin A-flat waltz.
That's right. And let us have the left-hand portion of it.
Faster!
Thank you, Mr. Levant. Now, if you can get the next one, you can save the $10 for us, Mr. Levant. Let's have the third and last.
Listen up.
Got it?
The more confusing. Wait a minute. I think it's the Chopin Nocturne.
Yes, it's the Chopin
very
Nocturne.
Very agitato part.
Quite right. That gives us 2 out of 3. Thank you very much, Mr. Levant. Farley Wheelwright of this city sends in the following interesting question, which I would be willing to make a small side bet of about a dime that you're going to plop on, gentlemen. Who died and in what sequence in the last scene of Hamlet? Who died and in what sequence in the last scene of Hamlet? Now, this is not one of those 4-hour Hamlets, Sir Cedric, in which the audience dies at the same time. This is the ordinary ordinary cut Hamlet. Mr. Kieran.
Well, the queen takes the drink, and she gets very, very sick. And I have to think a minute to see whether Hamlet stabs the king before that.
You see, you're confused already.
Well, the queen dies.
Do you want to give queen top billing and make her die first, Mr. Kieran?
Now, wait a minute.
Yes or no?
Wait,
Wait,
I want to talk
Kieran.
To Sir Cedric a minute.
Oh, you're not allowed to do that. Oh, that's thoroughly dishonest.
I think the king is the first to actually die.
Have you ever acted in Hamlet, Sir Cedric?
Yes, I have.
You have. And you never noticed who died in your little play, did you?
Well, so many people die. I was the first one to die always.
Ah, yes. Now, you think the king died first?
Well, I died as soon as the curtain went
up. Oh, no. Sir Cedric, ladies first, you should know that. The queen died first. First, the queen. And who died after the queen?
Laertes.
No, the king. Get your king in, Sir Cedric. The king, how did the king die?
The king dies because he's run through by Hamlet with his sword.
Yes, that's right, stabbed by Hamlet. And he died a second death, as a matter of fact, because not only was he run through by Hamlet, but what, Sir Cedric?
Drank the poison, too,
making assurance doubly sure. Getting double insurance, so to speak. Mr. Kieran, how about the third death?
Third death was Laertes.
Third death is Laertes, and the fourth gets kind of easy.
Was Hamlet.
The fourth was Hamlet. Well, gentlemen, I don't think you did quite... as well as some of you might have done.
That's disgraceful.
Sir Cedric, next time you do play in that little play, will you remember how the characters die at the end?
I certainly will.
The queen, the king, Laertes, and Hamlet. I'd like to take 5 or 6 seconds off, Sir Cedric, and ask you why it is that gentlemen of your profession always want to play Hamlet. They do, don't they?
Yes, I think because there's more variety in the part of Hamlet than in any other part.
That's it. And doesn't it enable them to be on the stage a longer time than practically any other players to mention? Well, Farley Wheelwright, courtesy of Canada Dry, gets $10 instead of the encyclopedia. Thank you. Now, gentlemen, here's one from Richard Richstein of Brooklyn, New York. A maritime question. On the decks of what ships, on the decks of what ships, were the following famous words spoken. There are three sets of them, three of them. The first is, I have not yet begun to fight. A very famous phrase, which we all learn in our American history. You'll admit that, Mr. Kieran?
Yes.
You admit you should know the answer,
that's
Mr. Kieran.
Right.
You feel pretty bad, Mr. Kieran, don't you?
Yes, sir. I think that was...
Mr. Adams?
I think that was the Bonhomie Richard.
That's quite right. And who said those immortal words, Mr. Adams? Who captained the Bonhomie Richard? Mr. Kieran?
I think it was a Captain Lawrence.
What was it? Don't give up the ship?
No, I have not yet begun to fight.
Wasn't it Lawrence?
John Paul Jones.
John Paul Jones, Mr. Adams. Mr. Kieran, you really should not have come in
on
that.
He was fighting this Serapis.
That's quite right. And during what war?
The Revolutionary War.
Yes, the Rebellion, as Sir Cedric would call it. The Revolutionary War. That's quite right. You may fire when ready, Gridley. Mr. Kieran.
That was said by Commodore Admiral Dewey on board the flagship Olympia.
That's quite right,
Mr. Kieran. In the Spanish-American War.
Yes, during what battle?
The battle way out in the Pacific.
Battle of Manila, May 1st, 1898.
Very good, Mr. Adams. Very good. And the third and last, kiss me, Hardy. Sir Cedric.
Lord Nelson of the Victory, Battle of Trafalgar.
It would have been a pretty bad thing if you didn't know that, Sir Cedric, wouldn't it? Yes. The famous last words of Lord Nelson on the Victory. Hardy, of course, was his flag captain. I'm sorry that we won't have time for any more questions and answers. The bell on our cash register has sounded three times, and that means that the goings-on this evening have cost Canada Dry a total of $30 plus three sets of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. And now, Mr. Milton Cross, will you take over for a moment, and then I'll report on next week's lineup.
Now, whether your holiday plans call for elaborate entertainment or just open house for friends, you can be sure that Canada Dry ginger ale and sparkling water will be welcome and congenial companions for these festivities. Canada Dry ginger ale, with its mellow, flavorful bouquet, is ideal for any occasion, with meals or as afternoon refreshment. For Canada Dry is an aid to digestion, a quick energy builder. In a word, it's ginger-vating. While sparkling Canada Dry water, the most popular of all club sodas, adds just the right amount of tangy goodness to your favorite drinks. And its 24-hour sparkle is your assurance their goodness will last on and on. So during this merriest of seasons, let these two fine Canada Dry beverages add gaiety and distinction to your holiday entertainment. Now, here's Mr. Fadiman.
Thank you, Mr. Cross. Sir Cedric, will you accept our thanks and the thanks of Canada Dry for coming down with us and shining so brilliantly this evening?
I've enjoyed it very much.
I hope you have, and we've enjoyed having you. Next week, our two faithfuls, Mr. John Kieran and Mr. Franklin P. Adams, will be with us, and we'll have two guests. The first has been with us before, and we're very glad indeed to have him back again. The distinguished biographer, author of Benjamin Franklin, distinguished biographer and literary critic, Mr. Carl Van Doren. And as our second guest, the charming screen personality, Miss Gloria Stewart. Now, will you remember, those who are listening in, to send your letters with questions and the correct answers to Canada Dry, 1 Pershing Square, New York City.
Remember, Canada Dry ginger ale and sparkling water are on sale in convenient sizes at your favorite neighborhood stores. The large family size sells for only 15 cents. The medium size, 12 ounces, 3 for 25 cents. This is Milton Cross saying goodnight for Canada Dry until next week at this same time.
Information, please, has been a Blue Network presentation of the National Broadcasting Company, Radio City, New York.